Hoy, martes 8 de junio de 2021, le damos los buenos días a toda la comunidad que nos sintoniza en tiempo real y al que nos sigue en otro momento. Les damos la más cordial bienvenida a la serie de seminarios del Instituto de Biología. Antes de comenzar, quiero solicitarles amablemente que se registren en YouTube para entonces poder interactuar en el chat, primeramente con su nombre, procedencia y nivel académico. Y segundo, para poder recibir sus comentarios y preguntas para el expositor del día de hoy. Es a través de este chat que le haremos llegar sus preguntas y comentarios al final de la conferencia. El día de hoy la presentación será en inglés, pero recibiremos sus preguntas y comentarios tanto en español como en inglés. Con esto le quiero dar la bienvenida a la maestra en ciencias, Andrea Jiménez Marín, quien es la encargada del Laboratorio de Biología Molecular del Instituto de Biología, para que nos presente al conferencista del día de hoy. Adelante, maestra Andrea.
Muted, Andrea.
Buenos días a todos, perdón porque tenía mi micrófono apagado. Para mí es un gran honor presentar al doctor Enrico Capellini. El doctor Enrico Capellini hizo su licenciatura en el Liceo Científico Carlo Cattaneo en Italia. Posteriormente hizo su maestría también en la Universidad de Turín y su doctorado en Ciencias Antropológicas en la Universidad de Florencia. Su línea de investigación se centra principalmente en los estudios de ADN antiguo y es pionero en los estudios de proteómica antigua y paleoproteómica. Ha coordinado el laboratorio de proteómica antigua en el Centro BioArc de la Universidad de York. Desde el 2013 es líder del grupo de proteómica antigua en el Centro Geogenetic del Museo de Historia Natural de Dinamarca y actualmente es el coordinador de la Red Europea de Formación Tempera, que es el Teaching Emerging Methods in Paleoproteomics for the European Research Area. Actualmente es profesor asociado en el Museo de Historia Natural de Dinamarca de la Universidad de Copenhague. Es referee en muchas importantes revistas científicas como Nature Communications, el New England Journal of Medicine, el Journal of Proteome Research in Analytic Chemistry, entre muchas otras revistas. Y ha obtenido varias becas como la Marie Curie en tres ocasiones y pues recientemente ha obtenido un grant que posteriormente Enrico les va a platicar de él. Y pues sin más por el momento, pues los dejo con Enrico. Gracias, Enrico. Welcome.
Thank you, Andrea, for your kind invitation. Thanks, Professor Rozas, for the kind invitation. And I would like to present here today the research line we have been developing here at the University of Copenhagen for the last few years. And it's in particular, I should mention, I'm part of the GLOBE Institute now, and GLOBE Institute is focused on development of methods for analysis of ancient biomolecules. Most of all, ancient GLOBE is well known for analysis of ancient DNA, but I would like to present the results of the line of research I'm pursuing that is mostly focused on ancient proteins. And we will see that we started with the first steps of this discipline with a limited approach, and now we're growing and finding new applications for this approach. So to put things in context, this is how science a few years ago presented ancient DNA. So with an entire issue dedicated to ancient DNA and a series of papers on the topic. And you can see that this slide is updated to early 18. After the first ancient human genome that was actually generated in our department, there has been a constant growth for ancient genome, full genomes, or genomes obtained by capture that reached an industrial scale. So from a few genomes in 2010 up to hundreds of samples, this is in 18, And now the top publication constantly go out with hundreds, and very soon, I guess, 1,000 genomes, ancient genomes. That issue that I showed you just before also came out with a short piece on proteins, because at the time the development of this field or this other approach was still marginal, and it's still, of course, less impactful than the analysis of ancient DNA, but at the same time, it's constantly growing. This is how, for example, in 2019, Nature presented the potential of ancient protein at the time, and the three main papers that I'm going to describe later all came after this one. But already at the time, there was in the air the possibility that ancient proteins could be used to reconstruct evolutionary aspects, and in particular human evolution, and we will see where ancient proteins can give its best contribution and why ancient proteins can be more effective than and useful than ancient DNA analysis. In particular, if we have a look at the history of this approach, we see that analyzing ancient protein residues is actually not so new, actually started even before the analysis of ancient DNA. And we can see here that at the beginning of the second half of the last century, it was possible already to observe amino acids, so the building block of proteins. A few years later, in the 60s, it started to be possible to investigate chirality and racemization associated with amino acids. In the 70s, the first identification of protein residues was based on antibodies. And after that, in the 80s, Edman sequencing. But all these approaches were either based on the analysis of bulk protein material, not sequencing, while Edman and antibodies based on identification and sequencing were not able to provide to be compatible with the characteristics of ancient DNA. So very low amounts, highly degraded and contaminated. It was with the introduction of mass spectrometry and then proteomic methods that it was possible to start to observe and sequence proteins in detail with much more stronger evidence. The technique is basically is called mass spectrometry, and it's basically a scale at molecular level, the outcome of the proteomic approach. Mass spectrometry based proteomic approach is the measurements of mass over charge for the species, the peptides that need to be ionized. The charge is very easy to calculate, so the mass can be calculated equally easily. And based on the masses of the fragments that are generated, it is possible to reconstruct the sequence of the proteins, modern as well as ancient. I have to say, we are based as Globe Institute in Copenhagen City Center, in the Geological Museum, the lower part of this slide. But when I arrived here, only ancient DNA activity was in place, and that was now a bit more than 10 years ago. At the same time, we had the luck to be very close to another institute that was instead very strong in proteomics, modern proteome analysis. So my suggestion when I arrived here to Denmark was, why don't we put the two excellences together to investigate ancient proteins? And that's where we started. And we do this in collaboration now. We have been doing this in collaboration with the Novo Nordisk Foundation Center for Protein Research. And this is a center focused on characterization of proteins and development of proteomic methods. And this way, we had access to the most advanced technology. This slide is now updated because all that set of instruments have been replaced. If we need to have a look at the experimental procedure that we use, you can see that in a way, just like ancient DNA, we collect fossil material, mostly mineralized tissue, so bone and teeth, but as you will see with a brief mention, also soft tissues or material that is not mineralized, in conditions of protection of the sample to avoid contamination from the operators. The material is fragmented, powdered, and then, as I was saying, we work with the same level of protection that we have for ancient DNA. The material is demineralized, and we follow a very simple procedure of usually, and we will see this is going to change, building disulfide bridges to liberate sulfidyl groups, alkylating them to avoid the reformation of the spontaneous reformation of the disulfide bridges, and then digestion with trypsin, usually a proteolytic enzyme that generates peptides, and the peptides are washed and immobilized at the end of this micropipette tip in a resin that is applied there, a CAT resin, and the material is analyzed for mass spectrometry. This leads to generate a set of hundreds or thousands of spectra that then need to be interpreted with the right software. And basically, this is an example of a spectrum as it comes out from the machine, and the software assigns the peaks to specific fragments that allow to support the reconstruction of the sequence. So here we can see a first aspect that is important to highlight, that the reconstruction of the sequence of each peptide is supported by the measurement of the mass over charge, or the masses of multiple fragments. So each peptide is supported by all these measurements, and all the measurements together contribute to the identification of the protein. We started a few years ago now, it's 2012, with this paper presented on the Journal of Proteome Research. And the main result of that work was demonstration that from a mammoth that was about 40,000 years old from Siberia, it was possible to retrieve more than 100 proteins. And this is particularly interesting because at the time it was possible to retrieve only about 5 to 10 proteins. So although it was not particularly informative in terms of advancement of knowledge in terms of for the biology of the mammoths, it was particularly interesting to see that we could retrieve those proteins, that those proteins were there and we could get them. This led to a series of other development and articles, and in particular we were able to see that it was possible to retrieve proteins from dental calculus. Dental calculus is oral bacteria, dental plaque, that is mineralized and accumulating on teeth when oral hygiene is not ideal and there's no professional oral hygiene treatment. And the consequence is that basically investigating dental calculus from ancient human remains, it was possible not only to reconstruct the microbiome, so the microbial population present in those communities, but it was also possible to reconstruct the biological processes that were going on. Because, for example, we retrieved peptides that belong to virulence factors, so peptides from proteins that are released by the bacteria in the oral community, oral microbiome, and that are responsible of triggering the infection process. And on the other side, it was possible to retrieve the immune response protein that the host was releasing to fight the infection. So in a way, unlike DNA, it was also possible not to see just who was there, but also what was going on, because some proteins are specific or strong indicators of specific functions. This is the second paper we published, but we went quantitative in this case, and it was possible for us to see that, for example, in this group of diseased organisms, it was possible to, of these humans, it was possible to identify two groups, one with a different oral microbiome from the other, one of them more inclined to disease, the other one less, different program of content compared to modern plaque and modern modern calculus. Similarly, we use the same approach on something totally different, that is artistic material. And in particular, we analyzed a conservation layer in a fresco material that originally was in Italy, now at the, well, for the last 200 years at the National Gallery in London. And it was possible, for example, to detect that this material was made of two layers, one including collagen, and it was possible to identify the animal species that were responsible for the, well, the source of, for the production of this collagen, so sheep and bovine, but also egg proteins that come from chicken and duck. And in this case, it was not only possible to reconstruct so conservation and treatment of this material, but also the kind of damage, the chemical damage that affected these sources. Specifically, it was possible to identify, for example, damage associated with light exposure, very important for paintings and painted material, and it was possible to associate damage that was due to the interaction of the protein residues with starch as a consequence of interaction of glycation. This is particularly interesting, and I wanted to give you a general overview of the analysis of ancient proteins. So reconstruction of diet, a reconstruction of oral disease, a reconstruction of painting. And now I'd like to focus instead on why it is interesting and it is important to characterize ancient proteins for evolution. The reason is actually that when you have DNA, it's better to analyze ancient DNA. Much richer information, almost full genomes, but as we will see, ancient DNA doesn't last forever, and it looks like ancient proteins can last longer than DNA and can be used to indirectly recover genetic information about species that went extinct beyond the limit of ancient DNA preservation. And the key for preservation of ancient proteins seems to be the interaction with mineral surfaces. And in particular, in this study, my colleague Beatrice, I was just one of the co-authors, investigated a protein present in eggshells, in this case from ostrich, so struzzocalcin, and she noticed that the farther you go back in time with eggshells that are older and older, and the oldest eggshells that were eggshell fragments that were analyzed date back to 3.8 million years from East Africa, for example, Old Dubai and Italy. The farther you go back in time, of course, you have a reduction of the peptides you can find, but the interesting part is that the peptides that survive are those that have a stronger interaction with the mineral matrix. This was interesting. At the same time, the value of this knowledge was more theoretical than practical, because with the recovery of peptides or a total recovery of a couple of peptides for 20, 40 amino acids, it's not particularly informative for any phylogenetic reconstruction. So let's go back to paleogenomics, and what we see is that most of the studies, so all those that were highlighted in my second slide, come from remains that are 100 or maximum 200 years old, and mostly from temperate and cold areas, not subtropical, not tropical, certainly not equatorial areas. For example, the most ancient genome retrieved so far has been published very recently, a few months ago, and dates back to a bit more than a million years ago. But it's possible to retrieve genetic information that is that old, because this material comes from Siberia, so from permafrost, areas where ancient biomolecular preservation is favored. On the contrary, if we look at the most ancient genome or genomic information that has been retrieved from temperate areas, then we have to look at Spain, and in particular to the site of Atapuerca, where remains of 430, more or less, 1,000 years ago, assigned to Homo heidelbergensis, have been sequenced. So you see that here, this horizon that is 1 million years old and beyond is completely inaccessible to paleogenomics. But if we turn to paleoproteomics instead, we start to see that it's possible to retrieve some sequences. In this case, of course, amino acid sequences. So the conclusion is paleoproteomics enable the molecular-based characterization and reconstruction beyond the limits of ancient DNA preservation. In general, this has been demonstrated before, and one of the first attempts is a successful attempt is in this study, and it's the characterization of, and the retrieval of proteins to allow the placement in the phylogenetic tree of this group of extinct animals, South American ungulates, that was particularly mysterious until not so long ago, because the challenge, basically in this case, was to identify whether the South American ungulates, mostly from Argentina, were close to Perissodactyla, so horses, rhinos, and tapirs, or closer to Afrotheria, so elephants and mammoths. Ancient DNA was attempted and failed multiple times. The characterization instead of collagen and just the retrieval of collagen from bone, so basically two genes, allowed to place the South American ungulates next or as a sister group compared to the living Perissodactyla, so tapirs, horses, donkeys, and rhinos. What you can see consequently is that for the first time, ancient proteins enabled the phylogenetic placement of a group that was not possible to place based on morphological evidence or based on ancient DNA. Actually, this could be considered a relatively low-hanging fruit, because here it was placing the group of the South American ungulates, or assigning the group of the South American ungulates next to two groups, either Afrotheria or Perissodactyla, that are phylogenetically very distant from each other. And even a molecule with a low level of variability, like collagen, is good enough to accomplish this task. Actually, things get a bit more complicated, and you will see, when you have to deal with discrimination, with taxa that are much more closer to each other. Incidentally, after the publication of these results, they were confirmed by ancient DNA analysis that finally managed to succeed specimens from this group, the South American ungulates. Moving on, the other application of ancient proteins for possible phylogenetic reconstruction was the characterization of dinosaur material. But assuming this data or this evidence is authentic, and there has been a lot of discussion about this, we see that the analysis of collagen sequences is, for the reason I mentioned before, not particularly informative, because even the assignment of dinosaurs as a sister group of reptiles or as a sister group of birds can be either true or wrong, it depends which is the amount of sequences you use. In this case, by by changing slightly the set of peptides used for the reconstruction, dinosaurs fall next to reptiles or next to birds. Again, collagen is not the best candidate for reconstruction of phylogenetic reconstruction, for reconstruction of phylogeny, sorry. Here you see three papers that we have been publishing in the last, I would say, almost 2 years now. And they are based on a different characteristic. This was something I figured out a few years ago now. And the characteristic is that the source of material of interest here is not bone anymore and not collagen, but is enamel, dental enamel. Let's see what happened. So, being part of the Center of Geogenetics here, I was involved in the characterization of some material that is extremely interesting, or better, from an extremely interesting site, that is the site of the Manisi. It's dated at 1.77 million years ago, and it is in Georgia, the country of Georgia in the Caucasus, east to the Mediterranean, as you can see, and at the confluence of these two rivers on the plateau of a volcanic area, this is where you have the site of Manisi. The site of Manisi, for people into the paleoanthropology, or specialists in paleoanthropology, is extremely popular because it's the site where this material comes from. So, these are five skulls of assigned to Homo erectus, and considering the dating of Manisi, 1.77 million years, these are and the set of human remains from Manisi represent the most ancient evidence of the presence of humans outside Africa. And of course, it would have been extremely interesting to have access to genetic information from these individuals, but considering the geography and the age, ancient DNA was almost impossible and turned out to be impossible. But at the same time, the possibility for us was to try proteins. It started to be clear for us, this is 2014-15, that it would have been extremely interesting to retrieve proteins. Of course, I didn't have access to this material. This is what I started with. So fragments of bone and teeth from large mammals, and at the beginning it was, I can guarantee you, extremely frustrating, because we were basically retrieving only collagen from bone in limited amount, absolutely not informative. So this would have not been beyond with a value that goes beyond curiosity. But when we start to look at teeth, and particularly at dental enamel, with a couple of changes in the methodological approach, we started to see more. The couple of changes from the methodological approach that needed to be introduced were basically removing all the part of breaking bisulfate bridges and blocking the sulfidryl groups with iodacetamide. And skipping digestion. This is because, just like people with ancient DNA, in high throughput sequencing, skip the process of shearing, so breaking ancient DNA, breaking DNA into small fragments for library building. At the same time, we decided, let's assume that time does the same job for us. In terms of hydrolysis and damage of ancient proteins. So let's analyze material that is undigested and see if the action of time took care of the fragmentation that we need to see peptides. So if let's test whether the peptides were generated spontaneously by hydrolysis due to the action of time over a bit less than 2 million years. Actually, we are right. This is the end of the story. But there's a couple of aspects that are particularly interesting in dental enamel. First of all, dental enamel is the hardest material in the vertebrate body. So a lot of fossil material, especially in the million year time range, is represented by teeth, and specifically the crown of teeth. The proteome of dental enamel is limited, but it's there. And it's represented by a few proteins listed here, amelogenin, ameloblastin, enamelin, and amelotin, that are responsible of the mineralization of enamel during amelogenesis, during enamel development. But there are also a couple of proteins that don't have organic matrix rule, but that are proteases, KLK4 and matrix metalloproteinase number 20, MMP20. MMP20 in particular and KLK are released during amelogenesis, when the component of mineral is still not at the maximum and the organic component in growing enamel is still high, to hydrolyze the matrix proteins, to the point that, for example, for a protein that like enamelin, that is initially has a sequence of about 1,000 amino acids, all what remains is about 100 amino acids, and this is due to the action of KLK and MMP20. Another very interesting aspect is one of the proteins that is present in amelogenin, in dental enamel, amelogenin, is present in two isoforms that are coded on the non-recombining regions of the X and Y chromosome. So male individuals have the X and Y isoforms, female individuals only the X form. As a consequence, when you find the Y isoform, you can be confident you identified a male individual. This is extremely interesting for aspects associated, for example, with sexual dimorphism, for when sex cannot be identified based on morphology. And this is how the peptides that we identified by skipping digestion looked like. So when you digest, you have the peptides that are one next to the other because they are cut by the enzyme trypsin in specific position. Here we can see the products of the spontaneous heterolysis due to the action of time. And you can start to see these fragments, you know, these peptide fragments, in a way has reads from ancient DNA analysis, and you can align them just like the product of shotgun sequencing. So it's interesting to see that some of these fragments partially overlap, and some positions are covered multiple times. Some others are instead covered a limited number of times, but if the quality of the spectrum is good, the identification is equally acceptable in terms of quality. And if we move a bit more in detail, we start to see that, for example, you have set of peptides like this one, where you have a peptide and the same peptide minus the terminal amino acid, minus one, minus one, minus one, minus one. You move in the following set of peptides one amino acid ahead, and again, you have exactly the same structure. And this is what we identified to be the consequence of terminal hydrolysis, so progressive removal of amino acid, of one amino acid from the end of the protein, of the peptide, and it's a clear sign of degradation. So let's go back to that set of bone fragments and teeth that we received from Manisi. Focusing exclusively on teeth and on dental enamel, we started to test them, and we see that there were some specimens with a very limited recovery, few peptides, 40 amino acids, but some of them, like the one here at the bottom, had a quite extended set of proteins and a quite extended set of amino acids. Here we are with a total of around 800-900 amino acids. And we started to see, so let's check if this amount of coverage, in terms of breadth of coverage, can provide any phylogenetic information. But before doing that, it was important to characterize the damage this protein material went through, also as a form of validation of the authenticity of this material. One of the reactions that we frequently observe in ancient proteins is associated with deamidation. So residues like glutamine and asparagine lose the side carboxy group to convert into glucamic and aspartic acid, respectively. And if we look at a control sample, that is enamel from middle-age material, so 5,000 years old material here from Denmark, we see a level of deamidation that is high, but not extremely high. With the material from Dvanisi enamel, we see that deamidation is very high, almost close to 100%. Well, sometimes it's exactly 100%. If we do a comparison with material from Dvanisi that is from bone, not from enamel, we see level of deamidation that are slightly lower, but higher than most of the cases than the control. So for the dental enamel material from Dvanisi, we see very high level of damage, which is compatible fits with the characteristic of ancient proteins. If we look at damage and we other kinds of damage, and we use the same approach that we used with the painted material, actually we see again a high level of damage because again, analyzing the control sample, we see for damage that is derived from one amino acid, multi different forms. So from tryptophan, different form of damage of tryptophan, we see very limited amount in the control material, very high amount of damage for, in this case, three that we used as example, three samples from Dvanisi. We see terminal hydrolysis, as we mentioned before, so progressive removal of a terminal amino acid. And also the distribution of the length of the peptides is compatible with a variation sample. So the Dvanisi material shows a distribution of the length of the peptide that is skewed toward shorter fragments. And we start from 7 here as a threshold. And we see that going ahead with the length of the peptides and the number of the frequency of the peptide with that length drops. On the contrary, for the medieval material instead, we see that the profile is completely different. So this is also a favorable indication for the conservation, for the authenticity of this material. We see also something else, that is a modification that occurs in vivo, not in vitro, in vivo. So a modification that is almost 2 million years old. And it's phosphorylation. Actually, if you talk to people that do proteomics or protein chemistry, they were, this was the case with our reviews, they were skeptical about phosphorylation that is that old, simply because in solution, phosphorylation is known to be quite unstable as a modification. But at the same time, here we think we have a good reason to support the authenticity of this modification. In particular, it's interesting to observe that, as we mentioned before, proteins preserve in time, protein residues preserve over long periods of time when they interact with the mineral matrix. Now, the mineral matrix in dental enamel is calcium phosphate, so with a phosphate component. And so the phosphate group that is connected to serine basically acts like a bridge between the mineral and the organic matrix in the enamel, stabilizing the organic component, the protein component. Actually, there's also another aspect that is extremely interesting, is that the phosphorylation of serine happens, takes place in a specific position. And in particular, if you look at the second position in the going through the C terminus, you see that there's a residue of E glutamic acid. When we started to look for motifs for phosphorylation, we saw that the presence of glutamic acids is extremely frequent. And actually, the presence of the after serine phosphorylated here in the position zero. And actually, it's extremely interesting to see that a motif that is called SXE or SX phosphorylated S is recognized by a set of kinases that are secreted and belong to the to this family, FAM20C. It is known that this kinase is responsible of phosphorylation of extracellular proteins that are involved in the regulation of biomineralization. So the fact that we observe a phosphorylation on this serine residue in this motif, from a biological point of view, makes sense. And we also know that phosphorylation of serine in this motif in modern protein, in modern enamel protein, is also reported. We also found isoforms, and isoforms associated with, for example, the presence of isoforms that are associated by different lengths of the same protein. Here we have a protein with the extended form. Actually, it's amelogenin X, but there's also an isoform that is truncated, so with a section from residue 250 to 181 that is absent. And we found peptides that are specific to each of the two isoforms, in particular bridging one and the second hand, or the bridge the version without the internal portion. As I was mentioning before, we also found peptides that are sex markers, and in particular, this was in another set, we found their proteins that were amelogenin in the Y isoform. And you see, we found that the peptides that support the male Y isoform, as well as we found the same in sheep material, hobicaprid material, of course, as reported here. And then we focused, because we get all this information, isoforms, damage, authenticity confirmed, we used all this material to see if the sequences that we were actually able to retrieve were authentic or not. And actually, I should point out that this work was done in collaboration with two members of UNAM. One is Victor Moreno Mejar, and Jasmine Ramos Madrigal is the other. But basically, of all the samples from the Albanese that we tested, we saw that the highest recovery, as I mentioned before, was on a rhino specimen. It's reported here. You can see it in multiple form. You can see that we cut out quite a lot here, and a lot of enamel was removed, because in the beginning we didn't know how to proceed. Then we learned a couple of things, and this way we were able to generate sequences. It's a Stephanorhinus, and ultimately the goal for us was to reconstruct amino acid sequences for what we could, with gaps in the areas where we didn't have peptides or spectra to reconstruct the sequence. The set of sequences reconstructed from the ancient specimen was aligned with the same proteins from living or extinct organism phylogenetically close, and this is just mean work. It was possible for us to come out with a confident placement of the Manisi rhino. In particular, it was possible to see that the Manisi rhino was a sister group of a group that contained the woolly rhino and another Stephanorhinus that was terminal. So this was much more recent. Actually, it was possible to have genomic information from these two rhino to have the Moloch proteins and to the one we retrieved from Banisi and build the tree. As a possible interpretation of this approach, we have that Stephanorhynchus is originally present in Eastern Europe and Western Asia, while Fully Rhino and the terminal Stephanorhynchus are instead present in Central Asia. And what is interesting to see is that probably a migration of Stephanorhynchus gave origin to these two species. The conclusion is that the group of Stephanorhynchus is currently paraphyletic. Once we add all these pipeline in terms of sample preparation and data analysis ready, we decided to apply it on something else. And we started to focus on another sample from an extremely interesting species, Gigantopithecus, from China. In this case, the challenge was represented by the fact that the material was more or less as old as Banisi, 1.9 million years, but it came from a much warmer geographic area, and in particular from subtropical China. This is the work done by Frido, and Gigantopithecus is extremely interesting and fascinating because we know very little about this species, but based on reconstruction, it could have been 303 meters tall and heavy and weighed 300-400 kilograms. We don't have much about this species because for Gigantopithecus, there's a rich collection of teeth in the order of a few thousand, but only for mandibles, fragments, and then nothing else in terms of skeleton. No skull or no postcranial, no other portion of the skull or no other postcranial material. As a consequence, the only difference associated with the primates was the huge size of these skeletons, of these fragments. That's why the reconstruction and the name Gigantopithecus and the reconstruction of the size and mass. At the same time, it was not clear what was the phylogenetic position for this species. So someone suggested it was on the hominin line, someone suggested it was farther behind on the primate line, that led to pan-gorilla and humans. Someone suggested it could have been associated with Pongo, as you can see it here, but not well placed. In terms of challenge, as I was mentioning, the fact that the material comes from Chaifunghe, which is in tropical China, leads gives the challenge of biomolecular preservation due to the high temperature in the area. And here you can see a graph where different sites and fossils from different sites and different geographic areas are treated with this mathematical model that defines what's called the thermal age. So the age if all the specimens experienced a constant temperature of 10 degrees over time. And you can see, of course, that those that experience the temperature that is higher look, have a thermal age that is farther back in time. All those that had a temperature that was lower have a thermal age that is lower than their real age. To make a comparison, the material for Chaifunghe, Gigantopithecus, is more or less as old as the material thermally old as the material from Old Hawaiian Italy, but there's a big difference that we retrieved hundreds of amino acids and they retrieved only 20, 40, as I said in the as I said before. If we look at damage, it makes perfect sense because the amidation is very high. Distribution of peptide length fits, makes sense, because the length is low, the peptides have a distribution that is shorter in general than Banisi, shorter than control material. If we reconstruct the phylogeny, what we see is that this material, Gigantopithecus, Then full closed to Pongo, so the orangutan material. This is the hypothesis that was best supported in the past, but it was still controversial. Now, with a molecular evidence, we can finally settle this debate. Of course, as usual, the phylogenetic reconstruction is done by Jasmine. The third application of our approach was, well, now that we tried on hominid material, why don't we try on a human one? We tried, and here you can start to see the limits of the approach as it's structured so far. So we had access to material as attributed to Homo antecessor. It's this human from a site in Spain, the one already mentioned before for Homo heidelbergensis. And basically, the site is in northern Spain. We will see in a trench on the sides of a trench that was dug in the past for a minerary rail line. This is when we visited the site together with Frido, Jasmine, and Petra, who also gave a crucial contribution to the study. And here is the stratigraphy. Burgos is in the northern part of Spain, north of Madrid, and this is the fragment we analyzed, a chip of enamel that was directly dated between 770,000-950,000 years ago. And I have to say we used it all, but now we are improving and there's less need for less material. And it is possible to see again once more that the damage profile is exactly the same we expect because it's heavily damaged. Peptide length distribution makes sense because this material is slightly younger, it's not as old as the Manesian Gigantopithecus, so the distribution is not so much skewed towards short peptides, but it makes sense. And we found phosphorylation, as mentioned before, and again with the SXE motif. And we found peptides that demonstrate it's a male individual. And the phylogenetic reconstruction placed Homo antecessor here as a sister group to the following, the more recent humans. But here we start to see a limit, actually a couple of big limits of this approach, because we placed our antecessor here, makes sense, so not particularly surprising, but at the same time, we didn't have enough information to say if antecessor is on a side group or it is a direct ancestor of the species that came later. And as a consequence, we can only say antecessor is basal to the others, but we don't know exactly how. And in the paper, we also report the characterization of dental enamel proteins from Homo erectus from an isolated tooth in Manisi. And actually, in that case, we didn't have enough information for a confident phylogenetic placement. This is a limit, and this needs to be improved. So let's try to wrap up, and let's try to see which could be the possible implications of the application of paleoproteomics to the reconstruction of human evolution. If we look at the species that have been characterized using ancient DNA so far in the hominin line, we see that, of course, it's the Manisi, Neanderthal, and Heidelbergensis. If we look at the chronological range that could be covered potentially by ancient proteins, well, the range is much higher. And it could be extremely interesting, for example, to characterize the last 3 million years. Here is antecessor. Antecessor is done. Could be done better, but we got there. Now, the challenge would be, considering that Homo antecessor, for example, is done, and that Gigantopithecus informed us of the possibility to retrieve proteins from subtropical environment, would it be extremely interesting to start to investigate other Asian and start with African species, possibly starting with South Africa. In particular, it could be interesting, for example, to start to look at the robustus Australopithecines like Robustus or Boisei, and ideally the human line with Erectus and Habilis. Extremely interesting would be Naledi and Flores, Floresiensis, for which we still especially Floresiensis, who is in the range of ancient DNA, but due to its origin in a tropical area, this makes impossible the recovery of ancient DNA. I don't know if we will be able to go farther back in time at the very base of the hominin group, but this could be extremely interesting. We're trying to do this, though, with a second European training network. So while Andrea initially mentioned Tempera, a couple of years ago, we were awarded another European training network. This one includes 14 PhD students, and we started the recruitment a year ago. It was, I was mentioning before the presentation started, it was tough because the Marie Curie program implies that fellows move within Europe or from outside Europe, from a country to another. And the people arrived in October and they immediately went in lockdown. So this year has been tough for a lot of people. But here is the group of colleagues that are involved in this project, and the early stage researchers, the fellows that started their PhD, and the research will continue also with another grant that they just received. That these arrived a month ago now, and it's called Backward, Overcoming Frontiers, the Frontiers of Biological Studies on Human History and Adaptation Using Paleoproteomics. In the aim is to develop new methodologies to go beyond the limits I mentioned. So, for example, dental enamel, yes, allow us to retrieve protein residues that are 2 million years old. At the same time, as a source of proteome, is not ideal because we cannot get more than 10 proteins when we're lucky. So, it would be good to obtain a much richer proteome, not from teeth, not from dental enamel, but from dentin or from bones in the same chronological range. And this is what we're trying to do with Backward. So we have push and backward. And with this, I'm going to conclude and say thank to all of you for your time and for listening to this presentation. The research done here was made possible by the general support of Villum Fonden, who is a Danish foundation for the promotion of science and research, and the European Commission that supported both Tempera and PUSH, and now is going to support also Backward, and in close collaboration with the Nordisk Foundation Center for Protein Research. With this, I conclude. Thanks so much for your time and attention.
Gracias, Enrico, por tu muy interesante charla. Vamos a pasar a las preguntas. A ver la pregunta. Nomi Chávez. Says, thank you for your excellent presentation. And they ask is what would the future of the paleogenomic?
Okay, thanks, Andrea, and thanks, Noemi. The future of paleogenomics associated with ancient DNA at the moment is characterization of as many samples as possible. In this case, my colleagues are working, as I mentioned before, with hundreds or thousands of genomes and do population reconstruction, migration, these kind of aspects, trying to go further back in time as much as possible. For what concerns instead paleoproteomics, so what we do, well, I gave a brief introduction in the last slide. The point is to try to characterize organisms, humans or hominins from Africa and Asia, and to try to go further back in time in the million years range and have clear phylogenetic reconstructions. What we cannot do yet, but we would like to try to do, is to get information also for possible hybridization processes or aspects that are a bit more complex. And this can be done if we can increase the coverage in terms of extension of the sequences, we will see. But we need richer proteins, richer ancient proteins.
Thank you, Enrico. The next one, please. Again, let me ask if this new approach can be a bridge between different disciplines to rebuild the evolution?
Actually, we are starting to talk to people we were not able to talk to before, simply because with ancient DNA we couldn't analyze species like Erectus or Gigantopithecus itself. So this is it starts to be interesting for us to talk to primatologists or to all those who are interested in characterization of species that are that went extinct more than a million years ago. At the moment, we are working on hominins and hominids, but whatever animal species that, or mammal species that went extinct more than a million years ago could be investigated in this way. This could be potentially extremely interesting. In terms of methodology, well, we started to talk again with people doing mass spectrometry and proteomics, and that was the beginning. And now the extension is with population geneticists who are specialized in this kind of material. So there's a development and interaction with people doing methodological aspects, and there's an integration with people studying specific species that went extinct more than a million years ago.
Yeah, thank you, Enrico. Ulises Rosas asked, what can you tell us about ancient proteomics and DNA genomics in plants? What will be a good preservation condition? What organs? What proteins?
Actually, for ancient plants, we tried something, well, now 10 years ago, that we stopped. But the interesting aspect in this case is that we can retrieve proteins from seed cells. So the target in this case is seed storage proteins, and the possible application is more on archaeological material. So identification, for example, of seed storage proteins from pottery to reconstruct, for example, nutritional aspects and use of pottery in the past. And actually, this is something we try in these days. We characterize instead for evolutionary placement some seeds that are 10 million years old, but we still don't know if they're going to work or not. So this is an attempt. But potentially, the application could be the same that you have if you characterize proteins from dental enamel. The now we don't know yet if we can find proteins that are million years old from plants.
Thank you, Enrico. Hernan Vasquez, it is possible to retrotranslate protein sequences back to DNA to have better data to interfere the pungent phylogeny?
Technically, no, because I don't think so, at least, because we know about the redundancy of the genetic code, and consequently, we cannot guess what's the sequence responsible for, what's the DNA sequence responsible for coding a specific protein sequence. And as I mentioned before, we don't know the total amount of sequence that we reconstruct is limited to a few amino acids, so we don't even cover 1,000 amino acids. You say here 19, maybe it's 1.9 million year divergence could still bear some level of incomplete lineage sorting. Possibly, yes. Incomplete lineage sorting is definitely a factor, especially with such a limited level of information. Actually, Jasmine is taking a lot of care to test and validate all these approaches, all these possible factors.
Thank you, Enrico. The next one, please. Jorge Nieto ask, have you found hydroxyproline residues in collagen from ancient samples?
The answer is yes. Hydroxyproline is a modification that is specific for collagen, and proline hydroxylation is always considered as a possible variable modification for ancient samples, just like modern ones. So yes, it's there, we see it ordinarily, but at least for what I know, it's not particularly informative on its own. It's also true that actually a possible, but I'm just thinking about that right now, a possible quantification of hydroxyproline could be associated with C vitamin consumption and metabolic aspects, but it would be let's say it would be not easy to make it methodologically reliable. There was this paper that came out more than a decade ago, even 15 years ago, about hydroxyproline recovery from Neanderthals. It was done in the lab that I just joined at the time. This was 2004, probably. But to have a reconstruction of physiological aspect based on possibly quantification of hydroxyproline would require a very strong methodological validation that I don't know how feasible it is. We should test.
There is another question from Jorge Nieto. Does hydroxyproline position in the amino acid sequence offers some taxonomic value?
We didn't use that, but hydroxyproline is present mostly in collagen, or almost exclusively in collagen, and in our reconstruction, basically we didn't use collagen. The amount of collagen we find, we saw when I was working on bone, I was only seeing collagen. That was not particularly informative. When we see collagen together with dental enamel, is usually can be either collagen 17 or it can be a residue of dentin, collagen that comes from dentin that we cannot we cannot clean away. But we never used it for as a source of taxonomic information.
Next one, again, Jorge Nieto, how about other post-translational modifications?
Post-translational modification are actually, well, we were looking for those because the approach we use for identification of damage also can look for post-translational modifications. We see sporadic modifications that are associated with damage, but hydroxylation phosphorylation of serine is the only one associated with in vivo modification. We don't find other source of in vivo modification. For the PTMs that instead occur after the organism dies, well, that defines all the set of damage, basically, but no other forms of in vivo PTMs that we can be confident about apart from phosphorylation of serine.
Thank you.
Bueno, pues creo que ya no hay más preguntas, ¿verdad, Andrea? Bueno, pues le vamos a dar muchas gracias al profesor Enrico Capellini y a su anfitriona, la maestra en ciencias Andrea Jiménez, quien nos hizo favor de invitar a Enrico para esta distinguida plática. Muchísimas gracias, profesor Capellini. Muchísimas gracias, maestra Andrea. Y con esto le queremos dar las gracias a toda la audiencia que nos sintonizó en tiempo real y a la audiencia que nos vio en otro momento. Los invitamos a que se suscriban a nuestro canal de seminarios del Instituto de Biología para que reciban notificaciones de nuestros seminarios institucionales, los cuales se llevan a cabo cada martes a las 11 de la mañana. El próximo seminario será impartido por la doctora Raquel Muñiz Salazar de la Universidad Autónoma de Baja California. Les reiteramos la invitación a la comunidad del Instituto de Biología interesada en formar parte del comité organizador de estos seminarios y del de Fronteras a que nos envíen un correo electrónico expresando su interés a fronteras@ib.unam.mx, puesto que el próximo lunes tendremos una reunión informativa con los interesados. Con esto le damos otra vez las más cordiales gracias al doctor Enrico Capellini. Muchísimas gracias. Thanks a lot, profesor Capellini. Y muchas gracias a Andrea por ser la anfitriona de esta sesión. Nos despedimos y nos vemos la próxima semana. Hasta luego.
Muchas gracias. Hasta luego.